Broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Office Hours. Tonight, we'll be talking about the College Instructor webinar. So the College Instructor tool. This is Frank Muehle, president and founder of Pegasus Lectures. As always, my contact information is here on the screen. Actually, let me get it. Pen so I can write. Here we go. So if you need to reach me, there it is. And just a little bit of housekeeping before we get started. Hopefully you can all hear me and see my screen. Right now, Cheryl is on the line, Cheryl Vance, and she's ready to answer any questions or at least watch for your questions. So if you have a question, there should be a little icon for a hand. You can raise your hand and she will unmute you so you can ask a question directly, or you can type the question into the chat and then she'll ask me when appropriate. Okay, so hopefully we're all good to go. So the outline for tonight, we're going to start off with very briefly because a couple people asked me about this, again, helping schools deal with COVID-19. If you've been on any of the other seminars, webinars we've had during the summer, you'll have heard me go over this once before, but I'm just going to cover it very briefly so you know what kind of help we do have for you if you're being impacted by COVID-19. I can't imagine that anyone really is being impacted by COVID-19, and obviously I'm being facetious. The second part will be about the instructor tool. What is it? And then the third part, I think, is probably the more interesting part, which is really the insights that we've gained from the instructor tool. It's a very powerful tool. It's giving us a lot of information. Some of that currently shows up in the instructor tool for you. Some of that will show up in the future. And so we'll see how that ties in with, we're going to talk about the next version of the instructor tool and open it up for you guys to basically send me other requests you have as we rebuild that instructor tool as we go move forward in the future. So that's what we're going to be talking about today. And so helping schools deal with COVID-19. So just so you know, we have extensive online distance learning tools that are customizable to your needs. We have additional college discounts for both partners and non-partners during this period of COVID-19. We know how hard it is and that people are struggling. We're adding additional free physics office hours for students, which we're going to talk more about the next date, and switching back to doing physics-related ones as students are coming back into the programs. And then perhaps most importantly, hardship cost reductions and waivers. So if you have students who are really struggling and you know that their financial situation is terrible, that they're really in difficult times, we will help out either reduce or waive the fees for their materials. Obviously, we need people to take this seriously and act as a line between students to make sure that needy students are getting this, because we can't do it for everyone, or we obviously have to, we'll go out of business, but we really do want to help the people who are struggling. So if you have students who have the need, please call us and we'll work with you and them to help them out. Okay. So, and basically tell us what you need and we'll brainstorm to see if we can help. Okay. So moving on to the instructor tool, excuse me. So the way you access it is through your My Pegasus account. So if you're a college partner and you click on the, if you go into My Pegasus, the bottom tab will say instructors. And when you click on that, it'll open up and it will show you all these lovely tools that you have, including ways to get to PowerPoints and downloadable chapters and quizzes and final exams, some videos on teaching ultrasound, some documents, and then there's the instructor tool. Okay, and it's also how you get through to office hours and various other free CMEs and documents, etc. But so you see a little icon, you click on that instructor tool, and that takes you to a page that looks like this. And there you can see that both the instructor tool includes both the USA program statistical results, if you're using that program, and then the exam sim statistics program, which is what we're going to focus on tonight. A few weeks back, we talked a lot about how you interpret the USA program and looked at results. So the way you would access that data is through this instructor tool when you click on that link. Okay. So before I move any further, are there any questions, Cheryl? Anyone having any difficulties?
Nope, everybody's doing great. Thanks, Frank.
Good. Okay, so the instructor tool is really a powerful analytics program created for comparing exam sim and case study performance by these various topics. So we're going to go through each one, and then, like I said, we're going to look more specifically at what kind of data we'd be able to pull from this analysis package. And I think it will tell you a lot about where students are at, what you can do to help improve your success with them and improve your teaching or improve the outcomes of your teaching, maybe we should say. So the first area is that we can do student analysis. So you can get a list of your students and you can see their areas of weakness per exam. Okay, and we'll see that in a minute. You can then look at class statistics. So you can compare your entire class for the performance, see how each student is doing against each other, whether or not they've passed. And you can look at this by exam, by multiple exams, et cetera. And I'll show you more about that in a little bit. You can also review how much time the student spent in both taking the test and in review mode. You can also look at the student's performance compared to their exam attempts. So basically you can see how the student's tracking over time as they're taking multiple exams. And then you can compare the student against your own college. So if you have multiple programs at your own school, if you don't, then that becomes basically the national statistics. You can compare against national statistics and see how your program is comparing against other schools without seeing the other school specifically, but seeing the national norms. And then finally, you can also look at topic analysis and monitor progress by topic and see how students are doing. Okay, so this is an overview. So what currently goes into the instructor tool? Currently, what's reported in the instructor tool are, as we said, the USA results, the exam sims. So we have the SPI physics exam sims, the abdomen, adult echo, breast, the nurse midwifery exams, OBGYN, vascular technology, and RPVI. And those all can go into the instructor tool. And then the case studies, adult echo, abdomen, and the semi-interactive console program questions as well go into this. And so basically, if you're using this, the exam sims, the case studies, the USA results, it automatically goes into your instructor tool. You don't have to do anything special. You don't have to ask for anything special. It's just simply by the use of these materials that you get access to this analysis program. So just briefly, because if you're not familiar with the exam sim, it's helpful to know what kind of information we do have access to in terms of the student's performance. So the exam sim uses a patented technology that I created, an algorithm and an approach, and it identifies specific areas of content weakness. It breaks down score by both topic and subtopic. It cross-correlates content based on difficulty, behavior, all sorts of different things the student does during the test. It looks at individual test-taking habits. It looks at how people change their answers, a student, and how it would impact their score. Time per topic relative to key concepts. It looks at details. It actually details question types participant gets wrong. And it looks at performance relative to cardinal test-taking rules. And so all of this information, basically, we have access to for the instructor tool. Now, currently, not all of it is showing up in the instructor tool, but like I said, we're going to be doing a new version of it. Talk about more about that later on. Most of this is, or at least a good portion of this actually shows up in the instructor tool in one form or another. Okay. So basically, if the student takes the exam sim or a case study, the analysis results, the student gets very detailed analysis, but then the instructor can see generalizations of the student behavior. So, we're going to start at the front or the beginning. So here's this student A, and we're looking at student statistics. So we're looking at just one exam here. And so these are the number of times that the student has taken the first exam. Of course, shows the date that they've taken it, their score on it, what's considered passing, the attempt number, the amount of time they spent, how much time they spent in review. and then the areas of greatest difficulty. Okay, and so at a glance, you can see what the student's having the most difficulty on. You can then select different boxes, as you see here, and you can then compare these results graphically and see how the student did. And we'll see that on the next slide. So if I were to select all three, this is actual student data, just anonymous. So this is student B. It's not the same student as the previous one. And you can see this is in the abdomen exam sim. And you can see in each of the categories, so the orange bar represents the first attempt, the green the second attempt, the blue the third attempt. And we can see that over time, the student got much better. Now, mind you, this is the same exam. So of course, we would expect to see improvement because they should, if they're seeing the same questions repeatedly, they better start getting them right. But you will also see later on some statistics that show that students, as they take more practice tests, even when they're different tests, will start scoring higher as they progress along because the process of taking the practice tests help them. Okay, so you can see this analysis per each student. And if they've done multiple exams, you can see all of the exam attempts, everything that you've selected. Okay. Now, this is actually the class statistics. And so here at a glance, what you see are the results of all the students. So in this case, students A through student J. And you see a bar that represents their exam score. And notice that right here, exam score is selected, but you can also choose time spent in exam or time spent in review. You can select which exam or exams you want to view and which attempt or attempts. And I'm looking at the attempts averaged. Now, in this case, the students took this exam twice, two times. So this red bar represents, as you see over here, the standard deviation of the scores. Well, if it's only been two tests, then basically the red bar shows what the two scores were the first time and the second time. So, and the average is the height of the bar. So this student here, the first time scored here, second time scored here, their average is here. Okay, so we can see that the standard deviation actually represents, in this case, because it's just two tests, really two different scores, okay? So we can see how much improvement the students had, right? The broader that red bar is, the more improvement the students had. If the student didn't retest, then we don't expect to see any change in the bar because there's not a second test to do. Or they got the exact same score, so close as in this student right here, you don't see much of a difference, okay? So we can see how the students did. And we can see that obviously this student had a passing score at some point. This one had one. This one had one. This one had a passing score. This had a passing score. These other students never did get to a passing score. Very close, but not to a passing percentage. Okay. And so it shows you what the passing score is in terms of questions, but then it shows this as a percentage, right? Okay. Any questions on that before we move on?
No questions, Frank.
Okay. So on this one, what you see is that it's now showing the time spent per exam. And later on, I'm going to show you something interesting, that how we see a correlation between the time spent per exam and the actual scores. But we can see here that the time that people spent on the exam, and we also see their scores, how their scores were actually ranged at the same time. So we're seeing the time they spent and then their score range. Okay. So basically what we're doing is we're moving down the tabs here, right? So we looked at student statistics, class statistics. We can either look at college statistics or national statistics. If your college, if your program doesn't have multiple school programs, then we're just going to fill it in with national statistical data. So what this is really good for is being able to, so let's say you have multiple programs and you have different teachers, or you have, you know, a program before and a program this year, you want to compare how the two are doing. You can then see how the class compares against the national. Okay, so in this case, I'm showing the national I'm just going to do the same thing at the college with multiple college programs. And you can see how your students are doing compared to national norms. So we see that for this school, and this is actual data, by the way, the students score typically a little bit lower than the national norm. Second test, a little lower. Third test, still lower. Fourth test, they actually do better than the norm. And then the fifth one, do significantly better. Why particularly for this school? I have no idea. I don't know if the school after it says you take it three times and then there's going to be some kind of group review or something, or if it's just the amount of time that's spent or what happens. But clearly, this instructor would realize that, gee, it's really important to get to that fourth and fifth attempt, because that's when not only the student's passing, but they're beating the national norms. Okay, so you can see there's a lot of information you can discern from these graphs. So now I'm going to transition, now that you know what the instructor tool is and what it gives you, I'm going to transition a little bit to instructor tool insights. So mostly, as you've seen, the instructor tool is giving you graphically showing this information, but there's a lot more that can be pulled from it from the statistics. And so the following pages that I'm going to show you actually show you what we've been able to pull from that instructor tool and learned about students. Okay. Any questions before we move it along?
Hi, Frank. We do have a couple questions. Do you have to manually input students into your college course to see the data?
Okay, so the answer to that is no. What happens is when you set up your class, our office actually creates the class. I believe it creates a class for you. So, so I'm remembering the administrator tool. And what happens is there's a list of student names on one side, and then you can transfer them into your class. And I believe that we can either do that for you or you can do it, but you don't have to type them in. It's usually when the student gets set up, we get the names, we put it into the tool, and then you can transfer them into your classes, or we can set them up for you.
And then a second question is, the instructor tool standard for the college partnership, or is it an upgrade?
So the instructor tool comes, so basically, if you're using our exam sims or our case studies, anything that would naturally show its results in the instructor tool, then you get the instructor tool as part of your program. So it's not an upgrade, it's free, it doesn't cost you anything. So if you're using exam sims, then we naturally will put the results into the instructor tool for you. There's no cost, nothing you have to do. You just basically are using the exam sims, we're going to give you these results. Okay?
And that's the last question. Thanks, Frank.
Okay. So let's see what we can learn about this, because I think as teachers, there's a lot of really valuable information. So I'm going to pose it to you as questions. I'm not actually going to have you respond, but just make your own guesses in your head, and then you can pat yourself on the back if you get it right. So what is the closest to the average percentage correct on our SPI exams? So is it 37%, 48, 59, 70, or 74? Okay. And the answer is 48%. So as the average percentage correct on the SPI exam, students get about 48%. So that gives you a benchmark as to how they're doing initially. So the next question, within SPI, which topic has the lowest percentage correct? So do you think it's mathematics? Do you think attenuation, transducers, Doppler, or artifacts? Within the SPI, I'll give you a second to think about that. And the answer is Doppler. And I'm going to show you more detail in a few moments. Okay, so Doppler actually ends up being the lowest. And then the third question, within SPI, which topic has the highest percentage correct? Is it waves, attenuation, quality assurance, artifacts, or pulsed wave? And I'll give you again a second to think about that. And the answer is actually artifacts. Okay. So these are things you can actually see from the tool, because as you look at national norms, we can see how students are doing against the national norms. You can see which areas are higher and which areas are lower from the national norms. Okay, so I'm going to actually look at some specific student results collectively over groups of tests. I'm going to start with SBI, but then I'm going to look at OBGYN tests, the abdomen test, echo, and vascular. Not in quite as much detail as SBI, but we are going to look at each of those and give you some summaries of what we found about students from these. So first of all, this is looking at over 550 exams that were analyzed, and the overall percentage correct was 48%, as I mentioned a moment ago. The best overall topics, as we said, was artifacts at 60% and waves at 57%. And it starts to become telling, and you'll see why I think it's important to look at this information as we start looking at not just this section and then in more detail, but other sections as well. See if you start seeing a theme develop as to why students have more troubles with certain topics than others. Worst overall topics, Doppler at 43%, transducers at 43.72, and math at 43.92, which almost says, look, these are statistical tie. You put math, transducers, and Doppler on there, and they're going to take a beating, right? And here's the thing. This is very, very heavily tested on the SBI test. It's the biggest category. This comes not too far behind. And then this, of course, impacts all of it because it's throughout the test. So let's look at this, drill down a little bit deeper. And so what you'll see is I color-coded the percent correct. So the darker red, the worse. The lighter, the better. It goes to yellow. If it goes to green, then that means that basically it's good. I actually had to reset my coding because I originally set the benchmark a little too high and everything was coming out red. So I had to readjust my metric so that the references would make some sense. So if you look at this, we see that the areas where the students are having the most difficulty overall is clearly Doppler. That's why I have that big red down arrow there. And we can see things like color frame rate, PRF, and temporal resolution. That's mathematical in nature, right? They just have to do actual calculations a lot of times. You can see display and processing. It's tough for them. Sensitivity, general theory, and Doppler equation. Again, the Doppler equation comes in there. So you can start to get a sense of where people are having more difficulty and less. Color flow direction is actually one of the highest in this section, although not particularly great. Okay. If we look at transducers, what's really interesting is there's virtually no variance here at all. There's virtually no spread, right? They're all in that 40% range. Okay, so whether you're looking at electronic steering, transducer types, backing material, etc., you can see that it's all pretty much, heterogeneous in terms of the response. You don't see a lot of difference in any of the sections. So overall, they tend to get beaten up by any part of transducers. Okay. If we look at math, so obviously I'm looking at the three worst right now. Then we're going to look at the better top areas. And we can see that logarithms and decibels, well, actually the worst one is dimensional measurements, distance, area, and volume. That's the absolute worst. And then not far behind is logarithms and decibels. Okay. And then you can see your way through to the rest. They tend to do okay in binary, probably because questions are relatively straightforward. They can memorize a few and get away with it. Okay, so the up arrow means that this is an area where they tend to do best on in the test. And we can see that general artifacts and artifact origins, 70.32%. That's relative to the results of the overall of this test. That's very high. Variations in reflection-related shadowing enhancement, 64. Helios and Doppler-related, 61. Nothing ends up being in the pink or red here. But we're still seeing stuff in the 50 percentiles, right? So that doesn't make it great. It just means my reference point here is that I don't color it red until it starts getting into the, below the 50s, okay? So that gives you an idea about how they do on artifacts. And then basically on waves, again, general waves, acoustic variables, frequency, and period, pretty well. And then if you notice amplitude, power, and intensity, Not surprisingly, this drops down because, again, there can be some calculations in here. As soon as there's calculations involved, we tend to see the numbers drop. Okay? Any questions on that?
Frank, we do have a question. It's not exactly on that, but it is, if you are using the supplemental exercises, will it also put this information into the instructor tools to track the students' results?
So what I'm going to say is I'm going to hold off on answering that question till I get to the end, if that's okay, because right now it does not, but I'm going to be talking about how in the future it is going to be. Okay? So right now the answer is no, but I'm going to talk more about what's going to be coming, and the answer will be yes at that point, okay? All right. So as I mentioned before, when I talked about what the exam sims can do, not only do they look at the topic and then break down those topics into subtopics and look at the more, you know, the granular detail of what specifically you're having difficulty with, but a lot of times students have difficulty with types of questions. And by that, I mean the way in which the question is asked of them. So they may be pretty solid on content, but they may really, really struggle with a certain type of question. And we see that, I mean, this is one of the things that is really, really interesting, is looking and seeing what types of questions people have difficulty with. So this little purple table here has a bunch of different categories. And so ranging from things like the semi-interactive questions, the SIC questions on the test, which is that newer, it's been on for quite a few years now, but newer format that the students really struggle with. And you can see 19.83% of the students get full credit. Now, it's a little bit misleading because on those credit questions, you can also get partial credit. And the students are scoring about 28% with an average score of about 0.5. You can get 2 points on those questions, so they're losing on average 1.5 points per question, SIC question. Okay? You can see how the second worst one is interpreting figures, drawings, and graphs. So that's at 39.4%. Then you can see a whole bunch of them there, relational logic and relational math, calculations and basic math, inversion, all true except questions with better answers, careful reading, questions with unrelated or expert missing information, order, those are all pretty low. Okay, the areas where they tend to do best, not surprisingly, equation identification recognition, because that's memorization. And you can see at the top, basic concepts, definition, and memorization, they do really well in that as well. So things where they memorize and regurgitate tend to do well. When you make them have to actually synthesize information, actually process it, actually do calculations, they tend to have a harder time with it, okay? So we're going to look at, just to corroborate what we just saw, this is an individual student's results, and you'll notice that it's in ascending order because I redid the graph. So I forced the graph to be in ascending order so I could see the lowest score to the best score. And this particular student is somewhat typical for a lot of students, and we see that Doppler is the worst, followed by transducer, and then mathematics, just what we had seen. Although statistically, students tend to score about the same on that. On this one, this student did significantly worse on Doppler and transducers and was a little bit stronger in mathematics, relatively speaking, to those other two topics. And then you can see artifacts is close to the top, and this student actually did better in pulse wave than artifacts, but it tends to be relatively consistent with what we see. And as I poked around and looked at lots of students this way, their student results, again, anonymously, I saw, again, this type of pattern that seemed consistent with what we saw statistically. So this is a student, multiple students on exam one. This is all their attempts averaged. And again, what we can see here is that red bar stands for the standard deviation. And we can see that all the students improved their performance by the next time they took the test, all passing except the first student who came pretty close, okay? And it does point out the fact that it's really critical that students not just take a test once, but they do it multiple times. And then really learn about their weaknesses, fix their weaknesses, go back to the foundational material, study that material, and then move on to the second exam, okay? Where then you can get a really good benchmark as to how much they've improved. So from first to second attempt of the same exam, depends how long has been in between, how much review has been done, how much that score increases. It's not really reflective of where the student's really at that point. It just shows the differential, and then potentially if they memorize, if they've learned something or remember something from previously. But the process of the redoing again and again is really important, because that's when the brain starts to develop those concepts, and you see it over and over again, you start to develop a comfort level. So when you get to the next exam, then you can really see whether a student's ratcheted up or not. And on a couple of reports I'll show you coming up in a little bit, we'll see that there tends to be pretty large jumps in student performance. So this is now looking at the class statistics, and you can see here there's 9 students being shown, and this is an individual test. And what we're going to do is we're actually going to compare the time spent with the actual scores. So I want you to remember, I'm going to flash forward and then I'll flash back, okay? So this is actually the time spent. You see right here, this is circled. So this is how much time each student spent on the exam. This is their corresponding scores. Do you see a correlation? You can clearly see that better scores resulted with students who spent more time, not surprisingly. And you can do the same thing with time spent in review and see those students who are spending more time in review and really, you know, taking advantage of the tools that exist versus just trying to coast through, okay? And so that's a real value, right, in that students will tell you whatever they think you want to hear, right? I studied my tail off. I worked my, you know, tons. I spent 754 hours doing this. And then you can point on, you know, with a simple little arrow here with the student's actual name there and see that they spent 17 seconds and say, well, clearly that's not the truth. So as we look at that, we see that there tends to be a pretty strong correlation between time spent and scores. Before I ask this question, any questions for me?
No questions, Frank.
Okay. So if there's no questions, we'll continue on. So my question to you is, the gray bars there are the class, and the second one is the college results. In this case, actually, it's probably a national average, but why do you think the scores for this class actually went down in the third attempt of the same exam and then went up on the fourth? Okay. And the reason, and this is something you can see within your own results, right, is the reason that the students who scored really highly on the attempt two, most of those students didn't take the attempt three, which means the top scorers came out of the bucket. So you had the lower scorers taking the exam. So those students may have actually ratcheted their score up relative to where they were, but the overall class average looked lower because we took the top performers out of here. We just chunked them out, like, because they didn't take it again. Then these students actually scored, and they actually score higher if you actually look at the individuals. And then you can see with the next test, again, there's again improvement, right? So, this is why you have to be a little bit careful when you look at graphics and graphical data or statistics of anything. You have to always think about what's the underlying principle. Why am I seeing this result? Is there something that makes it make sense? Okay. So the summary of the SPI is, in terms of subject material, students are weakest on Doppler transducers and math. In terms of question types, students have the most difficulty in questions that involve interpreting figures and graphs, and calculations and extreme difficulty with the SICK questions. Students are losing on average 7.5 points per test on SICK questions alone. Most students fail by fewer than 7 points, so that gives you an idea. And notice that math calculations comes up as an issue, both as a subject topic and as a question type. So it points out something that obviously causes difficulty for students. So if we can focus more on that area, then you can potentially help your students more, right? I know they may find it more, quote unquote, more painful initially, but that's where the help comes from, right? So we're going to look at briefly the abdomen overall. So in this case, I'm looking at the abdomen exam, sim results, again, through the instructor tool. We looked at over 225 exams that were analyzed. Overall percentage correct, a little bit higher at 65%. Best overall topics, we have integration of data, correlative testing, ultrasound examination, and pathology, trauma, and inflammatory conditions, okay? The worst overall topics, patient care and invasive procedures. Okay, so I don't know about you, but when I saw patient care was one of the worst topics, it scared me. And then the other one was ultrasound physics instrumentation, was one of the lowest. And you're going to see that as a common theme. And in almost all the topics. By the way, I'm not the one who wrote these questions on this test. So you can't just say, oh, it's because you write harder tests, because I didn't write it in this one or in the other ones. And it almost always is the lowest area for each of the students. So clearly they have a weakness when it comes to the physics and instrumentation portion of it. So in terms of subject material, students were the weakest on invasive procedural ultrasound physics and instrumentation. Specific weakest areas are guidance methods and techniques, emergency results, reporting transducers, vascular AP, pancreas. And again, this is stuff that you can get from that instructor tool. A little bit more challenging now in the future. I will be making it easier for you to pull this information out. In terms of question types, students have the most difficulty in questions that apply physics concepts to US imaging and identifying structures interactively. So now we're going to look at the OBGYN overall. So the OBGYN exam looked at 150. Overall percentage correct, 52.94. So not too far away from the physics results. Percent increase from exam one to exam three. So this is a new attempt, 16% change in score. So we're seeing a pretty significant or dramatic increase. Best overall topics, you can see them there, patient care, testing and pregnancy and pelvic pathology. Worst overall topics, first trimester normal, second and third trimester abnormal, first trimester abnormal, and second and third trimester normal. I don't know about you, but when I looked at this, I said, kind of shocking. This is the foundation of OBGYN, right? And it's the area they're doing the worst on towards the end of their program. In terms of subject material, students are weakest on first and second, third trimester normal abnormal. Specific weakest areas are growth, IUGR, macrosomia, oligo and polyhydramnios, uterine, malignant pelvic pathology, etc. In terms of question types, students have the most difficulty in questions that involve questions with better answers, inversion, and careful reading. Overall percent correct between topics is relatively consistent. So we're not seeing a huge difference between each of the topics like we did with, say, physics. We see much of more of a uniform spread. Students improve consistently between each exam. Adult echo overall, this was actually looking at the data a while back, so we didn't have a lot of exams in it, data. It's only 25 exams. Overall percent correct was 72%. You can look at the numbers again here to see where they did the best over the worst. Not surprisingly, here again, we have ultrasound physics as one of the worst, Doppler again, and hemodynamics, of course, and then congenital heart disease. And I guess I don't think it's too much of a stretch to figure out why that would be the case. We've already said were the worst. The specific worst areas were post-op, congenital, systemic hypertension, RV volume overload. In terms of question types, students have the most difficulty in questions that involve applying basic physics principles and instrumentation. There it is again, in calculations and equation knowledge, and with a surprising difficulty in diagnosing from video. So vascular technology, very quickly, 150 exams, overall percent correct, 54%. Again, we can see the best areas there, ultrasound identification of anatomy, procedures, and quality assurance. Worst. And again, we see hemodynamics and signal processing, pathophysiology, correlative test procedures, et cetera. And each of the worst topics involves more you can see why, again, these are the worst, right? So it involves more indirect understanding, how things interconnect. Again, that synthesis of information. That's where students struggle. And that's kind of the point of looking at all this data, right? Of looking at the test results. Because it's one thing to give students tests and say, yeah, they pass or they fail. Wonderful. It's a simple benchmark. But there's so much more information there. What are they struggling on? Why are they struggling on it? Is there something common to those areas that they're struggling on? What can be done to improve that? Right? How do you fix that so the students do better overall and then, of course, end up giving better patient care? So if we summarize, in terms of question type, students have the most difficulty in question involve careful reading. Overall percentage correct between topics is relatively consistent, almost all within 7 or 8%. So again, this test, we don't see a lot of variance in this test. So the overall summary is physics has not only the lowest passing percentage as an exam, SIM, but is also almost always the lowest or closest to the lowest topic on specialty exams. So that tells us something, okay? It tells us that if we can put a little bit more emphasis on getting the students over that hurdle, not only do we help them pass the SPI exam, but we also help them pass the clinical exams, right? Because the physics is one of the lowest topics on every specialty exam. Repeatedly, we see that students perform worse on question types that involve applying physics concepts, careful reading, calculations, and equations. So if you know this, you can basically pepper the students more with this and start helping them develop the skills to do better in this type of question, right? So you're basically preparing them better so that they'll do better as they move forward. A disturbing but not surprising trend that shows students routinely do better in questions that require direct recall and less synthesis of information. But as we all know, a good clinical person has to be good at synthesizing information because you're taking multiple pieces. You're taking the patient history. You're taking what other tests have been done in the past, what other tests have been done recently. You're looking at what you're seeing on the screen from multiple modalities, and you're synthesizing all that together to determine what's wrong with that patient. And so the very thing that they end up being the weakest on is what we have to focus on the most to improve them overall. So what are the overall recommendations based on this? Improving physics score should improve the clinical score, as we saw, right? If they do worse on, if that's one of the worst topics in each of the clinical tests, if you can make their physics score better, you'll also make their clinical score better. On the SPI exam specifically, improving their six scores can already mean 7.5 points. I mean, that's a lot right there, right? One type of question. Do more practice exam. Every time we looked at the data from exam one to exam two to exam three, even though they're different exams, look at just the first attempt, we saw those scores ratcheting up each time, okay? Doing more practice exams makes them better. Teachers can make better use of the analysis tools. If they understand the tools, they know they're there, right? You can use these tools to then figure out where the students are weak and then figure out how to help them. Force students to spend more time reviewing what questions they got wrong and why, right? Really understanding why they got it wrong. Spend time teaching students to think, to synthesize, to really think. They need to be tested on this skill routinely. And then longer duration classes would help to allow time to truly learn new concepts, because new concepts take a while for the brain to actually grow the new dendrites and actually hold that information. So by doing iterations, by teaching a concept and then going back and teaching it the next week and then going back and teaching it the next week and then review it again the next week, by having these classes that are longer duration, you can have that iteration, which is really critical for people to really gain new concepts. Okay, so before we talk about the next version in the future, are there any questions for me?
No questions, Frank.
Okay, so we have begun working on the next version of the instructor tool. There are significant additions and improvements planned. So I put these into buckets, if you will. So the first thing is, We plan to add e-course status into this program. So the e-courses themselves will also feed into this program. So we have a whole series of e-courses. And then what we can basically see is you can see the student. And if you have the e-courses that you're using, you can see if they've actually watched them, how much time they've watched them, reviewing whatever else. If there's questions associated with those, you'll be able to see their scores on those as well. Okay. So another data point that tells you how the students are doing. If you flipped your classroom and you're using the e-courses, that this will be in there. It's not in there now, but it will be as we move forward. Okay. The other one was what someone asked the question about adding book content. And I'm going to show this more detail in the next slide. But we plan to add significant amounts of information from the actual book itself, because we really have a lot of interactive aspects of the books. And I'm going to talk specifically about the physics one first, but in time, the other ones will also feed into this program as well. So other plans are to have easier to use interface, better graphics, and additional calculations and statistical tools. Because as you can see, there's a lot of information in this. And I was very afraid when I first put it out that to overwhelm people and that. So I try to keep the graphics relatively simple and straightforward, use graphical tools. But I'm starting to think that it might be beneficial for those people who really want it to be able to give them more statistical tools and say, okay, I'd like to be able to do a correlation between time studied and score results, okay? Or to look at student performance versus normative data and look more specifically at that. So those are the kinds of things I'm thinking about adding in as we're redesigning this tool. The other thing is integration of USA results. So actually more integrating in the results. So instead of it just being in there, as you move forward, you can then be able to go back and correlate what you see with students' performance with the actual results of the USA test, if they took that as an entrance exam. And then a method of inputting student scoring. So you can track if the student takes a credential exam, what their scores were in there, if how you rank the student clinically in terms of physics and those other things. And then we can use that data, again, anonymously, but to better analyze the results of the USA test and then improve those results as well. But then you have a more comprehensive picture of the student when you're done, okay? And then my question to you is, what would you like to see added? And I'm going to leave that as an open question. You can email me with suggestions. But just to remind you what my email is, it's my name, F. Miele. And then simply at pegasuslectures.com. Okay. So if you have ideas of what you would like to see in this tool, like I said, I'm in the process. I have a bunch of the design mapped out, but it's not completed. So we can add other features if there's something you really like. You say, wow, it'd be the coolest thing since sliced bread if you could do this. Well, maybe we can. Maybe I haven't thought of it, but if you think of it, you can tell me, okay? Any questions before we?
No questions, Frank.
Okay, so as I said, I talk a little bit more about 6E, the book content, and where that's going to be going to. So what we'd like to do is, because there's so much, first of all, as I said, the physics, really that interactivity is so critical, right? When you read a physics concept and it's on a piece of paper, it's dead. But physics oftentimes requires movement and really being able to visualize a concept. So we have all those conceptual animations that are up online, right? So we have a series of images as well that can further take, you know, because you can only fit so much into the book. We have all sorts of questions and review questions and supplemental exercises and exercises and chapter tests and all that stuff. So basically what will happen is in the instructor tool, your students who are using the physics book will there be at a glance, you'll see all the students on the page and you'll be able to see basically across what their performance is, where they're at. So if they've completed all of chapter 1, 2 and they're partway through chapter 3, or whatever it is, okay? And so if someone's supposed to be in chapter 7 and they've only completed up to chapter 3, or everything is only half full, then you can say, uh-oh, this student's in trouble, right? But then you should be able to simply click on the student name, and then you can drill down to that student. You can see the true status of the work completed. So the idea is you have to click on individual student, drill down, and see, have they viewed all the animations in each chapter, for example? Have they completed all the exercise? What are the scores on those specific exercises, supplemental exercises, etc.? Okay, so that's what's coming as we move forward. And so the idea is that we're starting to integrate even more all of the tools, both in terms of how they function, but also in terms of how, as an instructor, you can see the, how the student's doing and see why they're doing poorly, right? So they take a test, they do poorly, and then you go back and you say, well, look, they've only done half the e-course material that they're supposed to do. They've only spent, you know, a very short amount of time on the extra materials and the exercises in the book. Well, it's clear what the, where the problem is. Versus someone who spent a ton of time and they're still not doing well. Well, now what is it? And you find a specific area of weakness. You say, okay, we need to focus on this. Are you having trouble with certain types of questions? Is it because of certain content that you're not learning? What's the real problem? We can fix it. Okay. So that's the idea. And this will be coming. And so I want you to save the date for the next office hours. It'll be September 22nd. And over the summer, we've, especially with COVID, we focused on really working with instructors and things that we could do to help improve, looking really at the USA program, at the RBRS system for being able to do training remotely, various other topics for instructors. But now that students should be starting to come back, we're going to turn back to physics-based office hours where you can submit questions, your students can submit questions, and then we'll be reviewing the physics during those meetings, okay? And so with that, I will say, if are there any questions first before I conclude the meeting?
No questions, Frank.
Okay. So with that, I say thank you and stay safe. And I do want you to read that little mask in the corner there. That's actually a mask you can buy, believe it or not. Frequency of bad physics jokes hurts. Okay. And with that, please, if you have any ideas for something that we could do to improve the instructor tool for you, please give me a shout out and I look forward to it. Everyone, please stay safe. Have a great evening.